Welcome back to another OpenAeros update video. Today we're going to jump into what's been happening on the OpenCPC project. You might remember that about a year ago we announced that we had a functional unit. Today I want to show you a new box that admittedly looks like the old box, but a better box and six boxes. They're actually kind of like gremlins. If you feed them isopropyl alcohol after midnight, you might end up with six of these things running around. Okay, so what have we really been up to? Most of the work this last year has been focusing on ensuring the device can operate for long periods of time, the software and firmware in the system are stable, and that the OpenCPC can operate in a wide range of conditions and doing stupid things like this. One of the biggest challenges in working with isopropyl alcohol is that, then that's the working fluid we use to condense the particles to grow them, is that it can absorb water. We spent quite a bit of the hot and humid Minnesota summer having to really understand the fundamental mechanism of what happens in our CPC, and we came up with some simple solutions that enable the OpenCPC to operate continuously, even during record-breaking humidity like we had in Minnesota last summer. So how have we determined it works for sure? Well, we headed down to the American Association of Aerosol Researchers, lovingly called AAAR, to talk just about that to a whole bunch of aerosol nerds. So we gave a talk talking about the performance and testing of this device, and what were the big takeaways, you might ask? That the hardware design works, we could produce six units, and most importantly, that they all agree with particle counters that cost a whole lot more than these ones. And that they do also do this in harsh conditions like high humidity. And you can actually check out a copy of or a video of that talk in a link below. So why does this all matter? Well, our goal with this project is to make tools that have as many practical applications in the clean air space as possible. So let's demonstrate. Let's say, for example, you have an air cleaner and you really want to understand how well it works. Now you could do something like take the counter here, connect a hose, and measure the ultrafine concentration in the room. Ultrafine particles are these really tiny stuff that are around us all the time, and because we measure them, you always usually have sufficient counts to do some of these experiments, and you don't need an aerosol generator. So we're gonna take the tube, and you could have saw that it was around 800 or 700 particles before. We'll put the tube against the filter, you're gonna notice that the counts go way down. And there we go. Okay, so that does really indicate that this air cleaner does function. Now, how well does it work as a personal air cleaner? Well, what does that concentration look like if we pull it a few feet back? So we're sampling that same concentration, and you'll notice the concentrations go back up to basically where we started. And what this really indicates is that personal air cleaning might be much harder than people think it to be, and having a CPC makes it easy to show that. Now, because we created a counter that can measure all these particles, you can also do other fun stuff too. Now, you might have heard that OpenAeros was one of the winners of the NIOSH Fit Test Challenge, and we did that using an OpenCPC. We also took some other technology that we've been working on, specifically the silicone and the open respirator work, to make a simple little probe that you can slide into the mask to do fitting without modifying the respirator. Now, I know what you're thinking, Aaron, look, it's going to create a leak. It's going to leak right where you slide that probe in, right? But it doesn't. And the trick is making it very conformable, so we use this very soft silicone, and we also have this very nice continuous taper, and it goes down all the way down to a half of a human hair in thickness, and that ensures that you have a good seal against the skin. Now, the proof is always in the pudding, as they say, and I do like me some pudding. So let's don a mask and connect the probe and see how well it works. Now, I'm gonna intentionally misdon this respirator by not properly seating the nose wire. I'm gonna take the probe, connect it to our sample line. You're gonna see it's about 800 to 900 particles per cc. I'm gonna slide the probe in, give it a quick little wiggle to make sure it's seated. And what you're gonna notice is that, well, the concentration did go down somewhat. It didn't go down as much as you would expect because I have a large leak. Now let's say I properly don this respirator and seal the nose wire. And what you will see is that that concentration continues to drop now to a much, much lower value. If I stop talking, it'll go even lower. And what this indicates is that I have a much better fitting seal now. And most importantly, what we can do is just slide this out, and I can ensure that the as-tested condition is now the as-worn condition. Now, we also did some formal testing on the range of masks of the crew at OpenAeros, and found that not only does it not cause a leak, but it doesn't impact the seal of the respirator at all, both during the installation, the removal of it. We didn't see any sense of leakage at all. The bottom line is this, though. When you make devices like this much more accessible to scientists, to engineers, and to citizen scientists, it gives them the tools to help them to enable a clean air future. If these things stay locked in just a few labs because they cost $30,000, we stay stuck in the current state. And so our job is to get these out of the aerosol labs and into way more hands. So stay tuned next week. We're going to have another update on just how we plan to do that. So thanks again, and we'll see you on the next one.